This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book on Naval Timber and Arboriculture by Patrick Matthew. Preface. It may be thought presumptuous in a person who has never had the curiosity to peruse the British classic authors on planting and timber, Evelyn, Hanbury, Marshall, Miller, Ponty, to make experiment of the public sufferance. The author does not, however, think any apology necessary, as if the public lose time unprofitably over his pages, he considers the blame attachable to them, not to him. A writer does not obtrude as a speaker does, but merely places his thoughts within reach. As the subject, notwithstanding its great importance, might per se be felt dry and insipid by the general reader, accustomed to the luxuries of modern literature, the author has not scrupled to mix with it such collateral matter as he thought might serve to correct the aridity. The very great interest of the question regarding species, variety, habit, has perhaps led him a little too wide. There is one advantage in taking a subject of this kind, that few professional literary critics can meddle with it, further than as regards style and language, without exposing their own ignorance. Yet will the author experience the highest pleasure in being instructed and corrected, wherever his knowledge may be found defective, or when speculation or misconception of facts have led him into error. Knowledge and truth is mental strength and health, ignorance and error, weakness and disease. The man who pursues science for its own sake, and not for the pride of possession, will feel more gratitude towards the surgeon who dislodges a cataract from the mind's eye than towards the one who repairs the defect of the bodily organ. Gordy Hill by Errol. September 10, 1830. End of the preface. Introduction. Navigation is of the first importance to the improvement and perfecting of the species, in spreading, by emigration, the superior varieties of man, and diffusing the arts and sciences over the world, in promoting industry, by facilitating the transfer of commodity through numberless channels from where it is not to where it is required, and in healing the products of those most fertile but unwholesome portions of the earth to others more congenial to the existence of the varieties of man susceptible of high improvement, water being the general medium of action, fluidity or conveyance by water, almost as necessary to civilized life as it is to organic life, in bearing the molecules forward in their vital courses, and in floating the pabulum, the raw material, from the soil through the living canals to the manufactories of assimilized matter, and thence to the points of adaptation. As civilization progresses under the influence of navigation, and the earth exchanges her straggling hordes of savages for enlightened, densely peopled nations, every climate and country will be more set apart to its appropriate production, and the utility of the great conduit, the ocean, will more and more be developed, and become the grand theater of contested dominion, superiority there being almost synonymous with universal empire, dry land only the footstool of the mistress of the seas. In the still hour which has followed the cannon roar of our victories, we seem disposed to sleep secure almost in forgetfulness that we possess this superiority, that we stand forth the champion of the world, and must give battle to every aspirant to the possession of the trident scepter. As soon as the recent principles of naval motion and new projectiles, conjoined to shot-proof vessels, shall have been brought to use in naval warfare, marine will have acquired a great comparative preponderance over land batteries, and every shore be still more at the mercy of the lords of ocean. When we consider the tendency of luxurious peace, the effeminacy thence flowing in upon many of our wealthier population, when we view, on the one hand, an entailed aristocracy, whose founders had been gradually thrown uppermost in more stirring times, the boldest and the wisest, but whose progeny, in a calm world, entailed to listless satiety, have little left of hope or fear to awaken in them the dormant energies of their ancestors, or even to preserve these energies from entirely sinking, and on the other hand, an overflowing population, Chained from the state of society to incessant toil, the scope of their mental energies narrowed to a few objects from the division of labor, all tending to that mechanical order and tameness incompatible with liberty. Thus, perhaps, equally in danger of deteriorating and sinking into caste, both classes yielding to the natural law of restricted adaptation to condition. When we reflect on this, the conclusion is irresistibly forced upon us that the periodical return of war is indispensable to the heroic chivalrous character and love of freedom which we have so long maintained, and which, Britain being the first in name and power in the family of nations, must be so influential on the morale of the civilized world. It is by the jar and struggle of the conflict that the baser alloy and rust of our manners and institutions must be removed and rubbed away. It is by the ennobling excitement of danger and of hardship that our generous passions must be cherished, and our youth led to emulate the Roman in patriotic thirst for glory, the Spartan in devotion their own ancestor, the more daring Scandinavian sea-king or rover in adventurous valor. Without, however, seeking the fight, yet in preparation for the perhaps not distant time when we shall face another foe, it behoves us, without any sickly sentimentality, to cherish our warlike virtues above all things, to attend to what must constitute the field of our fame, our marine and the material of its construction, naval timber. End of the introduction. Part 1. Structure of vessels. Vessels are constructed of wood under two forms, plank and timbers. Plank, the out and inside skin of the vessel timbers, the ribs or frame which support the plank. Section I. Plank. Trees intended for plank ought to be reared in close forest or protected situation, drawn tall and straight, or what is preferable for a part with a gentle regular bend, technically SNY, figs, verses and X, next page. It requires to be of clean solid texture, from 12 to 40 feet in length, and at least 8 inches in diameter at small end or any greater thickness. For the conveniency of transport, oak plank timber is generally squared or planked where grown, and is cut out from 2.5 to 7 inches in thickness, and from 6 to 18 inches in breadth. Plank is needed of such various dimensions, that any oak tree of clean timber, nearly straight one way and straight, or with a gentle regular bending the other, may safely be cut into plank, the section to be in the plane of the curve. Figs, V, X, Y, Z represent the most advantageous forms of logs for cutting into plank. The dotted lines show the section of the saw in planking. The straighter the log is in the plane of the saw, it is the more suitable, as the planks bend sufficiently sideway by steaming fig V, of considerable bend and taper, where the planks, when cut, have a bend edgeway is the most valuable. This form requires to be very free of knots. In straight planks, fig Z, cleanness from knots is not such a desideratum. Figs. ZY of any length best long X from 25 to 35 feet, VV from 12 to 24 feet. In the above cut, for distinctness, the saw is drawn entering the butt. In practice, it enters the top. When planks are cut out where grown, they are sawn from the round log immediately after it is felled and barked, which not only prevents injury from drought cracks, but produces also a considerable saving of timber and labor, as the wood is softer when green, and the center planks can thus be had much broader than after squaring the log. The outer part of the matured or red wood, which is partly cut away in squaring, is also the cleanest for bending. The sap or not sufficiently matured wood, when left on the side of the plank in the vessel, wherever it is not always soaking in water, is only useful to the shipwright, as it decays in 2 or 3 years and demands an expensive repair. When plank timber is squared, it is for the conveniency of carriage and stowage, and where timber is of little value. Of British trees suited for plank, the most valuable are oak, Spanish chestnut, larch, redwood pine, and sometimes beech, elm, plane, ace or pseudo-platanus underwater. As no timber decays underwater for a considerable length of time, when put in fresh, unless it be devoured by the sea, worm, beech or any other hard tough wood is nearly equally good as oak for outside plank, under light water. Mark, provided the timber be hastened out of the bush into the vessel, or be kept in pools, either in log or plank, till used or be planked, and the plank kept dry under cover. One summer on the ground will generally render a beech log in the bark useless. Directions for training plank timber. Divide all branches into leaders and feeders. Leaders, the main or superior shoots, which tend to become stems. AAA, feeders, the inferior branches. BBBB. Should more than one leader appear, from the time of planting the tree till it attain the required height for the plank, shorten all but the most promising one down to the condition of feeders, making the section immediately above a twig, preferring one which takes a lateral or horizontal direction. The dotted line crossing AA. Should any feeder, below the required height, become enlarged beyond its compeers, such as B, reduce it to equality, V dotted line, or prune it close off if this should be necessary to the symmetry of the tree. Cut off, close by the trunk, all shoots which rise at a very acute angle with the main stem, such as C. There is a triple reason for this. They rise up and interfere with the more regular horizontal feeders, tending also to become leaders. They do not form a proper junction with the stem, by reason of the wood, as it swells, not being able to throw up the bark out of the narrow angle. Thence the bark of both stem and branch is enclosed in the confined break, and the wood never unites. Thence disease is liable to be generated between them, or the branches are subject to be torn down by the wind, and should they ultimately come to be removed, being then of considerable size, and the section from their perpendicular position being partly horizontal, as the sides of the wound swell up, the rain lodges in the center and generates rot. These nearly perpendicular branches generally originate from improper pruning, springing out where a large branch has been cut away. Lop off all branches, which, by taking an irregular direction, incline to rub upon the more regular. Also remove all splintered, twisted, and diseased branches. Do not cut away any of the lower branches, feeders, till they become sickly or dead. By pruning these prematurely, you destroy the fine balance of nature, and throw too much vigor into the top, which in consequence puts forth a number of leaders. You also diminish the growth of the tree by the loss of healthy feeders. The timber of the tree, increasing in proportion to the quantity of healthy branches and foliage, the foliage being the stomach and lungs of the plant. You also, by diminishing the number of feeders, increase the comparative size of those remaining, which throws the upper part of the stem into large knots, improper for plank, and renders then future excision dangerous, as large feeders, when circumstance or decay require their removal, or when they are rifted off by winds or snow, leave wounds which often carry corruption into the core of the tree. After the tree has acquired a sufficient height of bole for plank, say, from 20 to 60 feet, according to circumstance of exposure, climate, and sea, and also as many branches above this height as may be thought necessary to carry on advantageously the vital functions, as the superior head will now sustain small injury by being thrown out into large branches and plurality of leaders. If it be oak, it will become more valuable by affording a number of small crooks and knees. It will then be proper, in order to have timber as clean as possible and regularly flexible, to lop clean off all the branches on the stem as far up as this required height. From the early attention to procure very numerous feeders, and to prevent any from attaining large size, the wounds will very soon be closed over, leaving no external scar, and as little as possible of internal knot or breaking off of fiber. There are many salves, panaceae, and pigments in use for covering over the section of removed branches, which in ordinary cases may occasion no injury, but they are unsightly. In wounds of beech trees, where the cut tubes are so prone to die downward a considerable way into the stem and to generate rot, an antiseptic quickly drying pigment might be beneficial. This and the time of the season for pruning, at which the cut tubes or fibers are least liable to die inward, deserve attention. We consider the spring the least dangerous time. Should a number of small shoots spring out in consequence of this last pruning, they may be swept down if good plank be desired. If not, they may remain, as their presence will not greatly injure the plank, and they occasion the stem to thicken considerably faster where they grow. Yet it is probable that in doing this, by obstructing the flow of the sap downwards, they may interfere with the natural enlargement of the roots, and ultimately be injurious. Some varieties, or rather, some individuals of oak, are much more prone to this sprouting upon the bole, after pruning, than others. Where the disposition exists in a great degree, it ought to be encouraged, and the tree set apart for the construction of cabinet work. This system of pruning, encouraging numerous feeders and one leader while the tree is young, and of allowing or rather inducing the branches, after the tree has acquired sufficient height, to spread out into a horizontal top, is in harmony with and only humoring the natural disposition of trees, and is therefore both seemly and of easy practice. The perfection of naval forest economy would consist in superadding, according to instructions to be given on training of timbers, a top of which every branch is a valuable bend or knee, though in consequence of the situation the timber will be fragile and of light porous texture. In pruning and educating for plank timber, the whole art consists in training the tree as much as possible, and with as little loss of branch as possible, to one leader and numerous feeders, and to the regular cone figure which the pine tribe naturally assumes. This can be best and most easily performed by timely attention checking every over-luxuriant, overshadowing branch and wayward shoot on its first appearance, so that none of the feeders which spring forth at first may be smothered, till they in turn become lowermost, and by the influence of rather close plantation, which of itself will perform in a natural manner all that we have been teaching by art, and will perform it well. This closeness must, however, be very guardedly employed, and timelessly prevented from proceeding too far, otherwise the complete ruin of the forest, by premature decay or winds, may ensue, especially when it consists of pines. Of course, all kinds of pines require no other attention than this well-timed thinning, and to have their sickly moss covered under branches swept clean down. Section 2. Timbers. Timbers, as before stated, are the ribs of the vessel, spreading out and upward, excepting at the bow and stern, at right angles to the keel and kelson, two large straight logs which form a double spinal support or backbone. The ribs or compass timbers in great public building establishments are sometimes bent by machinery after being softened by steam or hot liquids, and for this purpose the cleanest, straightest wood is requisite. We, however, do not believe that pieces of great diameter, bent artificially, can have equal strength and resilience, as when grown bent, the fiber must in some degree be crippled. We admit that timbers and frames may be built of separate bended pieces of no great thickness, and have all the strength and resilience of natural bend. The strongest and most elastic mode of forming vessels would be to compose them of different layers of plank over each other in diagonal fashion, or at an angle 60 degrees, but the labor and inconveniency of these modes would be great. We will not admit that an experiment between the strength of a piece of coarse cross-grained timber, half naturally bent, half cut out of the solid, and that of a piece of clean timber, artificially bent, is any proof on the subject. Let us produce a clean natural bend, exactly fitted to its place, without any section of fiber, and make experiment with it. But at any rate, as this plan, bending of timbers, has never been adopted to any extent in our private building yards, we must doubt its economy, either that the practice is of no considerable advantage, or that the requisite machinery is too expensive for private establishments, and conclude that fine bent timber still continues a necessary in the formation of at least our mercantile marine. Of the very ingenious innovations in the structure of vessels contrived by Sir R. Seppings, by which knees and crooked timber might nearly be superseded, we can only say, the practice is not followed, and at least in private building yards, not likely to be so, that the demand for fine crooked timber comparatively is and will continue to be as great as ever. Should our war navy, from the introduction of steam impulse and bomb cannon, be reduced to fleets of strong gunboats, the demand for crooked timber, instead of lessening, will greatly increase, the building of frames of straight timber being more expensive and less suitable in small than in large vessels, And should war occur in the hurry of the formation of a new war navy under a different principle, the speediest and simplest mode of construction will be followed. Nearly two-thirds of the timbers of a vessel consist of the curves and bends A, B, C, D, E, F. The other third is of straighter timber and easily obtained. All timbers require to be straight in one way in the plane of their side, and the sides generally to be square. The undermeasures embrace timbers of appropriate size for vessels, from 50 to 500 tons register. It is seldom that merchantmen are required under or above this size. Of course, large war vessels require timbers of larger dimension. The corresponding timbers of vessels of different size are nearly similar figures, and the length of their respective lines, not far from being in the ratio of the cube root of the tonnage, a little deeper and thicker in the smaller vessels. When timbers are formed of larch or pine, they require to be a little more in diameter than when of oak. Fig. A flat floor from 9.5 to 18 feet long, that is, 9.5 for a vessel of 50 tons and 18 for one of 500, and from 9 to 16 inches deep at middle, thickness 1/4 less than depth, the diameter increasing in proportion to the length. When fillings such as S are used, flat floors are cut from straight logs. B. Rising floor shorter and same depth and thickness as former. C. High-rising floors from 4 to 8 feet in length of wing and a little deeper and same thickness as former. From the difficulty of procuring this bend, the wings are often used of unequal length. According as the timber turns out, the shorter wing to exceed 3 feet, and more when of considerable diameter. Floors are of every rise from A to C, being flattest at midships and rising gradually as they approach the bow and stern. In all timbers, it is necessary for strength that the fiber of the wood extend from one end to the other without much cross grain. Sea lines on high-rising floor, C. D. First foot hook, from 7 to 13 feet long and from 7 to 14 inches deep, thickness 1/5 less than depth. E. Second foot hook, from 6 to 10 feet long and from 6 to 13 inches deep, thickness 1/6 less than depth. This curve, when of great size, is valuable as breast hooks curved timbers stretching horizontally within and at right angles to the bow timbers to support the bow. F. Knees. The one wing nearly at right angles to the other, from 2 to 9 feet in length of wing, depth at middle as much as possible, thickness from 4 to 12 inches, generally required about 3.5 feet in length of wing and from 6 to 8 inches thick. Knees when large suit for high-rising floors. Fig. H is a valuable piece and easily procured by bending the young plant. When cut, it forms 2 second foot hooks. Figs. A, B, C, D, E are suitable, though the part cut off by the dotted line be a-wanting. In good work, this plan is often followed and a cross-chalk put on. Vid. S, left side of the cross-section of a vessel thus timbered. By this mode of building, vessels can be constructed from much straighter timber, and the vessels are superior from being more elastic, but from the nicety and expense of the work and waste of timber, the practice is not much in use. Cross-section of a vessel at midship's knees not inserted. A first foot hook alternates with each floor and second foot hook, alongside, extending from O to Q, and a top timber or third foot hook alternates alongside of each second foot hook and chalk extending from Q to A. These timbers are bolted together and constitute a frame or double rib, and the skeleton is composed of a series of double ribs, several inches separate, of course, wider above than lower down, as the timbers decrease in thickness, to within a little of the bow and stern, where the timbers are usually placed singly, without framing. In large vessels, a fourth futtock is used, then straighter timber is suitable. The knees occupy the position at X, stretching horizontally along the inside of the vessel and end of the beams. Of British trees, timbers are formed of oak, Spanish chestnut, larch, redwood pine, redwood willow, the stag's head osier, Salix fragilis, and sometimes the broad-leafed elm, Ulmus montana, underwater. In Britain, crooked oak for timbers is found chiefly in hedgerows and open forests, where the winds, casual injury, or overhanging superior branches have thrown the tree, while young, from its natural balance, or by the tree, from open situation, or excision of lower branches, parting early into several leaders, which in receding from each other form curves and angular bends. On the continent of Europe in the natural forest, it is chiefly the tops of old lofty trees which afford the crooks. In consequence, those we import are, for the most part, of a free, light, insufficient quality. To procure a sufficiency of excellent crooks, every person who has the charge of young plantations of timber, intended for naval purposes, ought in the more exposed situations not favorable to the growth of plank timber, or timber for bending, when the plants are from 3 to 15 feet high, to mark out the most healthy, suitably formed plants, sufficiently close to fill the ground when of the proper size, say 6 yards apart, and to bend these as the underfigures will illustrate. The dotted portion is the growth after being bent. The bend of floors requiring to be at the middle and of angular bend, see Fig. F, young trees of 1/2 the required length, should have the earth removed from the bulb of the root from one or both sides according to circumstances, and the tree and stool partially upset to windward, that is, generally southwest. The operator in effecting this may be assisted by a strong pronged instrument, then fixed in this inclined position and the earth filled in. This inclination may be given at planting, when the plants are tall. The best mode of securing the larger plants in their bent position is by rods, forked or hooked at one end, the other end nailed to a ground stake, the upper end, if forked, firmly tied to the bent plant by mat or straw rope. Smaller plants may be secured to the notched tops of stakes by ligatures, and the smallest, particularly larch, pinned down by small stakes with hooked tops. Advantage may also be taken of an adjacent tree of small value, and which would ultimately be required to be thinned out, to tie the bended standard down to the most convenient part of its top or stem, lopping off all above the ligature, if it interfere with the standard, and barking it near the ground, to prevent much future growth. When the workmen comprehend the required bends, they will fall upon methods of fixing the plants in the most suitable position, better adapted to the locality than any directions can teach. The plants will require to be fixed down at least 2 years, and bent a little more than what is requisite, as in their after growth, they have generally a tendency to become straighter, from depositing the thickest layers in the hollow of the bend. A fine regular curve may be obtained by bending the plant for several successive years, a little lower every year. This gradual lowering does not so much check the growth of the leader, nor tend so much to cause the feeders upon the upper side to push as leaders. When oaks are bent, great attention must be paid to cut away any ground shoots, and to cut off or twist down any strong feeders that stand perpendicular on the upper side of the tree, and also for several years afterwards to look over the trees twice a year, correcting any exuberant feeder and destroying root shoots. The forester ought to keep in mind that his pupils are proverbially pliant, and that, should his growing timber not be of the most valuable and most appropriate figure, he must rank either with the negligent or the incapable. Ship timbers being generally required of greater depth than thickness, that is, broadest in the plane of the curve, hedgerow is better adapted to growing them than the forest, especially when the trees are close in the row. The bend generally takes place across the row, and the bole of the tree acquires a greater diameter in that direction than in the line of the row. If the figure of the top of a tree be very elliptical in the horizontal plane, the cross-section of the bole, instead of being circular, will also be elliptical, cake-grown. The lateral spread of the roots in thick-planted rows being greater than the longitudinal, also tends to give elliptic bole, the stem swelling most on the sides where the strongest roots enter, which of course always occurs on the sides affording most nourishment. Forests intended for ship timbers might be planted and kept in rows a considerable distance apart, with the plants close in the row, and thus acquire the elliptic bowl. This would also facilitate the bending. By being turned a little right and left alternately, they would spontaneously, from the weight of the top, and their inclination to avoid the shade of each other, increase the original bias. Were forests planted in close double rows, the plants thick in the row, with wide avenues or glades between, many of the trees would acquire crooked boles, and the crooked might be retained when thinning. Avenues of this description would form agreeable diversity from the monotonous irregularity of the forest, and be highly picturesque. Were close triple rows planted with wide glades between, having spruce, larch, birch, or other trees of more rapid growth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.